skylines. They captivate our imagination. They represent what's possible, the manifestation of someone's vision. Where once there was nothing, now stands giants, the pillars of capitalism. But what if the future wasn't just about going up? What if it was also about going within to bring consciousness to capitalism? Building a world of abundance in support of the greater good. I'd rise for that. As an iconic entrepreneur with an incredible rags-to-riches story, you are a remarkable example of the power of the human spirit and what it takes to achieve the extraordinary. You went from twice being homeless to building multiple billion-dollar brands, yet through it all, you've always remained true to your philanthropy motto, success unshared is failure. What are some of the values that your mom showed you as a little kid that still resonate with you today?
Growing up in those days, Mom really struggled a lot, and we never knew it. She never showed it. My mom was such an incredible lady, and I think the thing that affected me the most was that about 6 years old, downtown Los Angeles, Christmas time, there's a fellow ringing a bell, and my mother gave my brother and I a dime, a little dime, and said, boys, hold it half and half and walk over and put it in the bucket. And we were little kids, we did. Then we said, Mom, why are we giving them a dime? Because in those days, a dime was two Coca-Colas or three candy bars. And Mom said, boys, that's the Salvation Army. There are people that have no food and no place to live. We could only afford a dime this year. That's all we could afford. But we gave something. And always remember in life, there are those less fortunate than you are. And give a helping hand wherever you can. But that never left my mind.
In the early days, you had many different types of jobs. How did working as a door-to-door salesman help train you to be successful in business?
Growing up the way I did in Los Angeles, having nothing but appreciating everything, you become very innovative. And the fact that you had a job was a big deal. Now, as far as training is concerned, where I really learned about people was selling encyclopedias door-to-door. I did it for 3.5 years, commission only and no leads. And after the first sale, I must have knocked on way more than 100 doors who were all closed to my face. And I say this to people as a little bit of a suggestion. If you want to know some of the secrets of success and in life, be prepared for a lot of rejection. Be just as enthusiastic on door number 101 as you were on the first door. Don't give up. Very important.
What's fascinating about your story is you've always seemed to have this amazing positive spirit, even during immense challenges. When was the first time you were homeless, and how did you get through that?
First, I was homeless. I was in my early 20s, had a 2.5-year-old son. I came home. My wife was walking down the stairs of our second-story apartment. By the time I made it to my floor, there's my son sitting in the middle of a bunch of clothes with a note. And the note read, can't handle being a mom anymore. He'll be better off with you. Goodbye. Unbeknownst to me, that was all orchestrated. She hadn't paid any of the bills for 3 months on the apartment, but I never knew it. I mean, there were notices, but she ripped them all up. She kept what little money we had. What other money we had in the bank, she took it all out. And I was in between jobs. It kicked my son and I out, and it was very tough. If you're this down and this out, you know, you could only go up. And Mr. Lee Meyer, one of my biker buddies, brought me into his house. Things were okay from there on out.
Resilience, grit, and determination are trademark qualities of your journey. In 1980, you started Paul Mitchell with just $700. Where did you get the idea, and what kind of hurdles did you have to overcome to get it off the ground?
My dear friend Paul Mitchell, who was a top hairdresser, he would sell the heck out of this little product line he had, but when he left, there were no reorders. So I said, Paul, we've been buddies for 9 years now. Let me reorganize. I know about formulation. I know where to go. I don't do hair. You don't do business. It's perfect. So we said, okay, let's start a company. And we had somebody want to give us $500,000. So I quit everything I was doing, right? Drove down the street to go to the bank to get the money. Never showed up.
Coming from nothing, grinding and running, struggling to survive.
Well, that wasn't gonna get me that. I said, Paul, how much money do you have? He says, JP, I'm on my last money. I can only afford $350. And I only had a couple hundred dollars in my pocket. So I went to my mom's house and I said, Mom, can I borrow $350? I didn't want to tell her, Mom, I'm starting a new company and I'm broke. Our initial vision when we started John Paul Mitchell Systems was something called survival. I just want to survive. I want to be able to get a place to live, food to eat. But I knew what we had was really good, and I just went right up a street in L.A. called Ventura Boulevard in the Valley. Beauty salon to beauty salon to beauty salon, knocking on doors, just like I did selling encyclopedias, till I got somebody to buy my product. When people ask me, when did you guys know when you officially made it? I know the exact time. We were 2 years old, and we had every bill paid on time. Not paid off, but paid on time. And we had $2,000 each left over in the bank. And I thought, man, we made it. We had no idea how big this company would grow. Making that money.
This is, of course, just part of your success story. Less than 10 years later, your next billion-dollar idea was born. What motivated you to start Patrón?
I helped this fellow who went bankrupt named Martin Crowley go into the architectural business. He would go to Mexico, and I said, well, while you're down there, why don't you see what the aristocrats drink? So Martin went down there, came back with these two really thin bottles, and it was smooth tequila. Very good. Martin said, I met a guy named Francisco Alcaraz that could make it smoother. I said, well, see what you could do. He brought back a couple bottles. I said, oh, this is really good. I want in on this. Let's go in the tequila business. Martin found that really cool bottle that Patrón is still in, by the way, and we made it. I'm a man on a mission. I'm a man on a mission. Now, we had a problem. It was so good. We had to sell it for $37 a bottle. The average tequila was $4 or $5 a bottle. The best one, I think, was $14 a bottle. So when people taste it, it's great, but no one's gonna pay that kind of money. I don't care how good this tequila is. We got a big distributor like Jim Beam to carry it nationwide. After a couple years with them, they said, guys, let's tell you the truth. You have the best tequila in the world, there's no doubt, but you'll never do more than 20,000 cases a year. It's just too expensive. Well, we dropped them. We took a distribution over ourselves. Needless to say, Patrón Tequila does in the millions of cases, so they were wrong. I'm a man on a mission. In business, one of the critical things is successful people do all the things unsuccessful people don't want to do. Don't believe people when they tell you you're going to fail. You can't do this, you can't do that. Don't believe them. Go with your heart and what you think is right and do it. Prove them wrong.
If there is anything that defines you, it is your philanthropy. Why is giving back so foundational to every single one of your companies?
My motto is success unshared is failure. Giving back I made as part of all of our companies, and I think that goes back from my mom. I know whether it's Paul Mitchell, Patrón, John Paul Pet, or even my new business, we make sure people are taken care of now and in the future. We support so many things. We give to about 165 different charities. Every one of my company's gifts, it's our culture, along with my Peace, Love, and Happiness Foundation. What happens in giving is this, it makes you feel good. Let's get together, let's get together, let's get together, like family. Many years ago, Bill Gates and Warren Buffett explained to me all about the giving pledge, and we pledge we're gonna give half of our wealth while we're alive or after we die to make the world a better place to live for humanity as well as the environment. I'm very, very proud. One of the greatest highs you'll ever experience, and I'm a child of the 60s, so I know we smoked in those days to try and get high. One of the greatest highs in the world you will ever get is to give to somebody else or help somebody else out. Ask absolutely nothing in return. Just feel good because you give it. It makes you a better human being.
Spending time with giants, it always shifts our perspective. They call us up, they give us their shoulders to stand upon. And from this vantage point, we start to understand there really are no limits. To heights, we can rise. No limits, you'll see.